So I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Hall when I was a trainee in cardiology at the University of British Columbia. And at the time, she was a very powerful influence on my career direction and inspired me to pursue an academic career.
Judith Hall was born in New England and credits her love of biology to family roots.
I was very much influenced by my mother, who was fascinated with biology. And so she would find worms or butterflies or some weird plant and always be showing them to us. And I think that curiosity really enhanced my sense of biology. I think sort of halfway through high school, I decided I wanted to go to medical school because you could combine science with being a do-gooder. And I had this strong sense of I should do something useful. So then when I got to medical school, there was an elective in genetics. Much of genetics at that time was looking at congenital anomalies, so I needed to go back then and do a pediatric residency. And then because I'd become interested in short stature, I did a year of endocrinology. What I loved was the clinic. And so once a week when there was clinic, and I actually got to see patients, I was just thrilled and fascinated by their diseases, by how the diseases affected them.
Judy really has had a career-long interest in a group of conditions defined by joint contractures, what we call arthrogryposis. And I think that her work, gathering data on thousands of patients from around the world over all her years in practice, has allowed her to analyze these conditions and classify them.
Over 300 publications in the clinical field and describe new genetic syndromes, including one that bears her name, Pallister-Hall syndrome.
There are several areas in which I was really interested: congenital anomalies, neural tube defects, short stature of various kinds, and then arthrogryposis, when you're born with multiple congenital contractures. And I've been involved in describing a whole set of very specific anomalies.
Almost uniquely, she seems to have an innate ability to hear things and see their relevance. And then again, think about where one would research next, what questions one would ask to clarify whether there is relevance to areas that are uncertain or ambiguous.
She always brings up an idea that nobody else had thought of, asks the question that really makes you think, wonders about things that you should have wondered about and that you go away wondering about after that, and really makes things fun. She's an idea factory.
She's a big picture thinker. She's able to see relevance and questions that maybe others wouldn't.
A brilliant scientist in the fields of genetics and pediatrics, but I've come to appreciate Judy beyond that because she so effectively embeds the lives of her patients in her understanding of the disciplines.
Judy taught me early in my training to value the interaction with patients in their support groups, lay support groups.
Working with parent support groups, they're just amazing. Of course, the parent of a child with a problem really cares, and so they're always asking the most profound questions.
When we're dealing with rare conditions, we will see a lot more in a week at a meeting than we would in 20 years in one's office, in one's clinic.
I particularly worked with Little People of America, Little People of Canada, and then transferred that to several other groups, particularly the arthrogryposis group, where they're now internationally linked up, helping each other internationally to encourage research, to be advocates for their particular diseases.
She really was one of the people in Canada who helped to understand the relevance of folic acid and how it can reduce the incidence of neural tube defects or spina bifida. But she went beyond that. She became an advocate for the fortification of food with folic acid in order to have an impact on the incidence of neural tubes, and government listened. That was an enormously important role that I think had consequences even beyond this country.
In genetic health care, she's been president of the largest human genetic society in the world. She's been president of the World Congress of Human Genetics. She's really influenced the development of clinical genetics in genetic patient care throughout the world.
Judy has been at the international forefront of genetics and pediatrics for more than four decades. I mean, she's a prolific writer.
One book was a book on measurements. So if you're doing congenital anomalies and describing syndromes, you can actually make it quantitative. And the other book was a book on congenital anomalies in general, which has really become a standard text.
She's been active in the Canadian Pediatric Society, the American Pediatric Society, international pediatric societies.
There's a certain time in your career when you understand enough about what's going on that you can have a role in developing new institutions. So we realized in Canada we didn't have a National Academy of Science and began to develop the Canadian Council of Academies, and I was really involved in that, and then the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences, and served on the Canadian Council of Academies Science Advisory Committee. Canada was lagging in the genomic research, and so was instrumental in getting the Genome Canada going and thinking through how it should be organized.
I think what I'd like to emphasize is the rich community of healthcare practitioners and scientists that she has inspired.
I've met people from all over the world who have told me that they first got interested in genetics or interested in child health after hearing Judy give a talk.
With each phase of her career, she has given of herself and influenced the generations of learners behind her.
An internationally distinguished clinical geneticist, a brilliant intellect, and global authority in her field. Canadian Medical Hall of Fame laureate, Dr. Judith Hall.